Morning, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Excellent. Welcome to the roadshow. I think we're on our sixth roadshow, not possibly seventh, not absolutely certain, but it feels like we've been doing them for some time, and it's nice to see lots of familiar faces. I'm Trish Hines, and I'm the Chief Exec, and joining me today is Adrian Hardman, who's the Leader of the Council. And I'm going to hand over to him in a minute, but just a couple of words of introduction. The roadshows are part of our commitment to good two-way communication with staff. So we're going to stand up and talk to you for about half an hour or so, but actually the interesting bit comes with what you say back. Okay, so please, please take the chance to ask questions, make comments. There is no such thing as a stupid question. Whatever you want asked, there will be somebody else in the audience that will think, well, thank goodness they put their hand up because that was just what I wanted to know. Okay, you can ask about anything that's on the presentations or anything else. All right, this is your chance to talk to us, and it's really important that we hear what you have to say. And if you don't say it, we can't hear it. Okay. Second thing for me is great to see a lot of you here today, but having this kind of two-way face-to-face conversation is always helpful, but there are a lot of staff who can't get to the roadshows. So can I ask you if you would please take some of the key messages back and share them with colleagues in team meetings or whatever other opportunities there are. Now, we're not doing handouts. No, because we'll do handouts at some of the other roadshows because we don't have an overhead presentation so easily in some of the offices. But the presentation will all be on SID. So if people want to come and have a look at it, go and have a look at it, they can do. But if you would please take personal responsibility for talking to your colleagues about the messages that came out today, that will really help us. That would be great. I think that's... Oh, and you're our first roadshow, so you're our guinea pigs. So a lot of the feedback that we get from you today may lead to changes about whether we, are the slides clear? Do we need to emphasise slightly different things? So your opinions today are doubly valuable. Okay, so with that, I'm going to hand over to Adrian, who's going to get us started.
Right.
Fun. Because this is the first roadshow, of course, it probably won't be as seamless as we find that by the time you get to roadshow number six. So you might just have to bear with me a bit. But I thought it was important today that I just said a few words before we go on to talk about the four main topics here that we put on, because I normally just talk to you very quickly about the economic outlook. And I think I said last year, there will come a roadshow where I'm able to say that the economic outlook is improving, the coalition is achieving all its aims, and everything's on target, and the sunshine is, well, about to break out. I'm afraid to say that, without doubt, this is not going to be the year when this is going to be possible, because as I just left my office, I noticed that Spanish government borrowing costs had gone up to 7.8% this morning. So, as is normal in August, we're heading for another really severe Eurozone crisis, I would suggest. Two of the Spanish regional governments, sort of equivalent of county councils, indicated over the weekend to central government that Catalonia, in effect, was bankrupt, and Valencia did it earlier in the week, which is adding to the uncertainty, because these are major regional institutions, a bit like the West Midlands, saying to central government, actually, we just can't pay our debts unless you give us an enormous amount of money. And this is still unresolved. I mean, the good news from our point of view is that our borrowing costs actually fell again this morning. So government, everybody still wants UK government debt, because while we've made some progress on rectifying the deficit, it's down by about 25%. We have been a bit surprised to see that we've had to slightly borrow more than the forecast in the last 3 months, because tax take from principally income tax was down by quite a lot. Part of that, I think, is just the fact that the City of London isn't paying any bonuses at the moment. Part of it is, I suspect, because high taxpayers are still trying to avoid the 50% rate. And part of it is just the straightforward sluggishness in the economy, because the economy is still only growing just. Looking forward, actually, I think that we might start to see the economy return to trend growth in 2013. The other plus side is that inflation is falling pretty sharply. But we were lucky enough to have the Governor of the Bank of England here to come and talk to a Find It in Worcestershire event about 10 days ago now. And it's quite clear from what he's saying, the bit that really concerns him, I suspect, under it all, is actually deflation on quite a wide scale. And deflationary spirals are very difficult to get out of. And so you've seen action comparatively recently where they're doing more quantitative easing. Now, quantitative easing has worked very well for the public sector. It's driven down our borrowing costs. And you're now starting to see monetary easing, in my view, which is directly aimed at the private sector with this injection of £80 billion into the banking system for them to loan out. And if they loan out at low rates, they get low rates from the Bank of England. So for those who aren't economists, I suspect that was desperately boring. But for those who are economists and, you know, and I've taken interest in the world and as county council employees, you know, we're not out of the woods yet is the overwhelming message that I come forward with. And the comprehensive spending review, which we will see in the autumn, everybody tells me is going to be as tough, if not tougher, than the last round. Now, I'm disappointed in this, because we were told in local government that the cuts in our funding were going to be front-loaded, and this is, you know, more of the same is frankly not going to be popular. But, you know, I think it's worth just not dwelling on the future negativity too much, because we've achieved some fantastic things. We need to save, and this is our latest guess, which is why the press, you might have noticed, has been saying, well, things are getting a lot worse. You know, we think that we are going to need to save at least £90 million, but the timescale is longer. We've already achieved some in the region of £60 million worth of savings, you know, £31 million delivered in the first year. And we are well on target. There is very little risk in the next stage of this. So, I mean, this has been a tremendous, you know, effort by all of you, because, you know, we're still running at two-thirds of it through straightforward efficiency. I know that none of you have had a pay rise for a number of years now. And that all adds into this. And so, you know, it's been a tremendous corporate effort, and there's a quick graph there that just shows the cumulative savings and where we think the graph is going to go, and it doesn't make particularly, you know, great reading, and I hoped that it was going to be in a better position than it is now. But we have, at the same time as being able to save all this money, part of what BOLD stands for is better outcomes, as well as lean delivery. And we have seen better outcomes. And I thought I would just, you know, highlight a few of them in a moment. You know, we've seen great improvements to the County Council website. Adult social care has got better. The positive activities for young people, I personally thought that putting £1 million into maintaining buildings for young people to have meetings in was a complete waste of money. The library service has done fantastic work. If I look across, you know, the rest of the country, our library service now has the highest numbers of users per pound spent. We've kept all our libraries open, and indeed the other day, you know, opened a new one. We're finding different solutions to how we manage the library service, and it's really good. Also, at the same time, as part of the corporate plan, we were putting more emphasis on children's safeguarding, because we were went into intervention. The Minister has now, you know, recognised the progress that we've made in children's safeguarding, and we're now out of intervention. So, you know, there have been a lot of better outcomes. And I just thought I'd highlight, you know, how Constantine has come up, because it's meeting the long-term needs of the residents. But the solution didn't come from County Hall. It came from the staff themselves, who said, hang on a minute. You know, and the manager of Constantine came here into this room and spoke very persuasively at Cabinet to us. And she said, you are missing a trick here. You are missing an opportunity. By moving to Woodlands, you will be able to keep this service going. You move yourself out of a Victorian rectory and solve, you know, a lot of, solve some of the problems while maintaining the service, but it was going to be delivered in a different form. Our website is really starting to improve, I think, dramatically. And I see one or two who worked here on that today, because, you know, part of ease of access to services must be through the website. We are becoming a much more customer-focused website. And it's going to put, you know, the customer back in the driving seat. One thing that Trish and I were talking about today was, you know, admissions to school placements, places. Because, you know, where we used to send a handbook to every parent, sent out about 70,000, actually they can access all this, book a place online. And if they can't do that, they can phone up the hub and somebody should be able to do it for them. So this, by moving to a more technological, you know, solution, and I have to say, sometimes I'm prone to say to the Cabinet, you know, come on, gang, Virgin Media tended to do this 15 years ago, saves us money, but also gives a much easier customer service experience to the customer. So I think it's, you know, important that I just talk through where we're going next, because what we're aiming for is to deliver a vision of what Worcestershire County Council is going to look like in 2016. And part of that is we're going to have, I know some of you are probably going to groan, but a refresh of the corporate plan over the autumn, and we will take that through Cabinet, through Council in February. So for the first time ever, our corporate plan will actually align with our resources. Because up till now, the two have been operating, I think, very separately. And I think this will be a good step forward for us to make. We're determined at the moment. We operate a large number of work streams. And we want to concentrate down into 12 or 13 really transformational work streams that will give better outcomes as well as saving us some money. There's quite a lot of work still to be done on how this is going to take place, because I'm aware that during August I will probably have to rewrite the first draft of the corporate plan to pick up and re-establish some themes that have emerged. For instance, the work on troubled families, we're probably going to give more weight to that. I'm also very keen, because some of you in the room will be aware of what I've called what is known as the Barnett Graph of Doom, and the latest census figures would just show to you what a dramatic challenge the county is going to face within a 10-year time period, because the census figures show that the number of people over 65 in the country increased by 11% nationally, but in Worcestershire from 2001 to 2011 increased by 22%. So we are getting older at double the national average. This is quite a young room, actually, as I look around it, but, you know, believe it, you really are. And what will happen if we don't start to really concentrate on this problem is that adult social care will, I dislike the phrase, but I'm going to use it, eat all the rest of the budget. That's what the Barnett Graph of Doom, you know, they say in Barnett in London, by 2026 on the current rate, They will not do anything but adult social care under current legislation unless something changes. Now, I'm getting a bit fed up with the dithering that is going on in central government over this question of adult social care, because out here in this county, we now just don't have the time any longer to consider options. We have to get on and do something. And the corporate plan is going to reflect that in February, when we start to make quite a lot of change in the way we operate, I suspect, with our health partners, if I can get them on board. So this is just a little sort of diagram that shows how we think this will work. The corporate plan will give direction to Bulb. Bulb will be the mechanism that delivers it. But at the same time, I'm very keen in the autumn that we do another round of consultation. And in some ways, this is the start of the consultation, because the majority of you are residents of Worcestershire. And as people of Worcestershire, you ought to have some say in how this is going to operate. Now, at that note, I probably talked far too long, I have. I'm going to hand over to Trish, and she's just going to run through one or two next phase programmes.
Thanks. We've got 13 programmes coming through in the next stage. So this is the shift that Adrian talked about. We've had up to 90 projects on board at any one time, mostly about efficiency, some about service reform, some about transformation. We're trying to shift that to 13 projects about transformation. A number of the existing board projects will come in and sit under these. I'm not going to spend an awful lot of time on this, but I'm happy to take questions about it as we get to the end. So, Future Lives, Pathway for Independence is in adult services. It's very much what Adrian was talking about. How do we invert the triangle of care? At the moment, we spend the most money on the smallest number of people with the highest level of needs. And that means we're not spending enough money earlier to try and keep people healthier and independent for longer. How do we change that round? And stuff like investing in what they call assistive technology. How do we use technology to help people manage their lives and be safer independently in their own homes for longer, as well as other forms of early support? Think Local in Worcestershire is the continuation of our how do we develop a localism approach. We've got a strategy going to council in September. We've been out to consultation with the public for several months about how do we develop local responses. Things that in the past have been seen negatively as a postcode lottery. And we're saying, actually, we see that as a positive, because we know our communities are all very different, and we want local solutions that fit the needs of that community, and we see that as local choice. As we change what we do over the next few years as a council, as our budgets diminish and as we focus more on our core services, and there will be some services where we will want to say to communities, like libraries, we can't afford to do this in the way that we've done it in the past. If this service is important to you, come and talk to us about how else it could be provided and how you might be involved in doing that. And actually, there are lots of services where we're really not very good at doing them. We're good at doing big strategic things. We're not that good at doing very small, different local things. And so finding other local solutions with other people will be important. Smarter working is about how we use technology to help us find solutions to the sorts of issues that we're facing as a council. Reducing the property portfolio is a real no-brainer. The less we spend on buildings, the smaller of a proportion of our budget that we spend on buildings, the more we have available to spend on direct services and the delivery of services, whether we do it ourselves or whether other people do it. So we're looking at, much as we've already done quite a lot of in County Hall, bringing our staff together into a smaller number of big administrative buildings, doing more around flexible and mobile working, finding ways to share buildings with partners. So we're looking at joint depots with the fire service and the ambulance service and the district councils, for example, because all of that takes up money. If we can release that money, that's savings that we don't have to make from somewhere else. Safeguarding children, I won't say much about because Adrian has touched on it. It continues to be a very high priority for us. We've come out of inadequate, we're now adequate. Our ambition is to be good next year and to be excellent after that. Improving educational outcomes has been a high priority for us for some time, but we're in a changing circumstances now. The role of the local authority in education outcomes has been changed by the government. We are no longer responsible for it. It has become the responsibility of schools. Our responsibility is about ensuring that there are sufficient educational places of good quality for the children of Worcestershire, and to challenge and support schools that are not meeting their responsibility to provide good educational outcomes. Now, that's a big change in our role, and we're still working out with schools how we're going to make that work. Our focus on this is going to be different in the years to come. And the innovatively commissioning early help is the same kind of principle as with adults. How do we invert the triangle of care? At the moment, we spend the most money on the smallest number of children and families who have the highest level of needs, whether that's because the families are very dysfunctional or whether it's because the children are disabled or some other thing, but very expensive services. How do we invest in services that provide early help in order for families not to, you know, for their position not to deteriorate to that level? Much better for us financially, but more importantly, much better for children and families. So early help, is you'll see an awful lot more of in the next year or so in children's services. The open road, this is about how we deal with our highways. At the moment, we deal with our highways by the road classification, so trunk roads, other A roads, B roads, country roads. What we've realised is that some of our trunk roads and some of our A and B roads are actually more important to the economy of the county than others. And so what this is proposing to do is look at how we focus on those roads that most support our local economy, because helping our businesses grow is what helps people get jobs, it's what maintains the prosperity of the county, and that prosperity is what pays for everything else, including public services. So we're looking at how we use our money differently. Social and community transport. We did a lot of work last year about bus subsidies. We took a lot of savings out of bus subsidies. It was an excellent piece of consultation work with the public. We ended up with a very high level of support across the population. Not absolutely everybody was happy, but generally speaking, a very high level of support. We think there is more that we can do. At the moment, we spend about £21 million of County Council money on a combination of public transport, usually subsidised services that can't be run commercially, home-to-school transport, and social care transport for adults and children. We think there are different ways to look at this, and there will be some local solutions. We want to talk to schools, for example, about whether they would like to have a devolved pot of money and organise their own bus routes, or organise parents into doing school runs on a joint basis, or whatever good ideas they have. We want to free them up to do that. We also, for those areas where commercial routes are never going to work, mainly rural areas, we want to get into discussions creatively with organisations like local residents group and parish councils about, you know, if we gave them some money to run a minibus service three times a week to the nearest market town, would that be a better way of doing it? So we're into some quite creative ideas about how we might do that. The last one says, waste disposal, the programme is still to be scoped, and that is because we have been waiting for the Secretary of State, Eric Pickles, to decide whether he was going to allow our energy from waste plant proposals at Hartlebury to proceed and give them planning permission, and on Friday he did. So we're now activating the plans that have lain dormant for 6 months or more on this to go ahead, and that will, waste disposal is not going to cost us less because of the taxation regime to try and prevent waste going into landfill. This is a challenge about how do we cap the increase in the costs of waste disposal by more recycling and using residual waste to provide energy and so on. And the last three, I think, optimising the use of self-service, Adrian has already talked about. How can we help people deal with us in the same way as they deal with their banks and online shopping and all of that kind of stuff? And we were looking at some proposals around school admissions today, which is a very different way of doing it. Innovations in commercials and procurement. One of the things, as we've developed our commissioning strategy, one of the things that we've realised is that while we're very good at some bits of it, actually there are bits of the commissioning cycle that we're still not very good at, and particularly around things like dealing with the commercial contracting and negotiation with the private sector, we need to strengthen our skills. And then shared services. We're still working on this, it's early days. We've got a very good track record in Worcestershire, shared services with district councils in the county and with partners, the NHS and so on. This is about looking at other upper tier councils, and a number of you will have seen stuff on SID or in the press about the Tri-Council project that we're working up with Shropshire and Staffordshire. I'm happy to take questions about any of those. But clearly there are opportunities to make sure that we can make savings, but also for some smaller and very specialised services that we can safeguard the knowledge that's needed to run that service effectively for our residents. And in order to do all of those 13 things, we've been working on what are the tools in the toolbox that staff are going to have available to them, okay, to help us do that. We're expecting you to work very differently in the future, and if we're going to ask you to do that, then part of our job is to help identify what skills you need that you might not have at the moment, and what tools will be there to help you do this different work, and the toolbox begins to address those. So I hope you all recognise the logo by our commissioning project. Our stated aim has been that we want to be an excellent commissioning council. We've got a much clearer idea about what commissioning means, the four stages of it, but as I said, we've realised we've got some skill gaps. We need to do some work around training and tool development. We're beginning to make real progress on this. We've been very clear as a county council from the very beginning that this isn't about outsourcing, although that might be the result. In fact, the county council has said quite clearly we are agnostic about the result. The result will be what the result will be once we've gone through the process. If the outcome is that services are better maintained in-house, then that's what will happen. If it is that somebody else will be better providing them, then that's what will happen. And in fact, one of the first processes that went through was the young adults team. The outcome was that it should be kept in-house because there were no providers out there in the market who could do it better than we could do it. So I just wanted to use that as an example to show we genuinely are agnostic about this. We've got four other projects going through the commissioning process at the moment. We've got transport, which is in the first stage about evaluate. This is the £21 million that we spend on transport. How might we do it differently? We've got IT support, currently in the evaluate phase. We've got safeguarding, which is moving around to the design phase, so lots and lots of work going on in children's services about not just immediate safeguarding and keeping children safe who are at risk, but the early intervention work about how do we stop those children getting to being at risk in the first place by putting in early support. And early help for children's services currently in the design phase. Streamlining management is a second tool in the toolbox. I hope most of you are familiar with the idea of this now. It's been around for about 6 or 8 months. We've done quite a lot of work on it. Adults and Children's Services particularly have done a number of deep dives on this. The idea being that if you limit the number of levels of management, not only do you get better accountability, but you get more streamlined management decision-making. And given that one of the big messages from our last year's staff survey was decision-making is slow and cumbersome and lots of people have to be involved, going up the line and back down again before you get a decision, we see this as a good way forward. So we're rolling out the DMA programme. The aim will be to get to an organisation that has 5 levels. So I'm level 5. Frontline staff and supervisors are level 1, and that leaves us with a team manager, a service manager or head of service, and a director in between time. So that's where we aim to get to. Many of our services are around 7 or 8 levels. Our longest chain of control in some of our provider services in adult care is 10, I think. So quite some way to go. We've worked out a programme that will take us around 90% of the council services over the course of the next 2 or 3 years, and we will be doing this as part of the bold project work. So it's not the case that a service will have to go through any changes arising out of a bold project and then there'll be another review to do with management arrangements. We'll do them together at each time. We're anticipating reducing about 10% of our taking out about 10% of our management posts. That's about 60 management posts, or about £3 million a year. Now, that doesn't make very comfortable if you're a manager, but I think a bit like property services, this is one of those things where if we get the spend right at management, we need good management, we need the right management, there needs to be enough but not too much of it, then that's money that's protected for frontline staff, frontline services. And we're now looking at how we roll out the all the really good information we're getting from the DMA reviews to look at things like organisational competencies, and I expect in the long run that we're going to be feeding this through into job descriptions, person specs, and staff appraisals. So if your management post has been reviewed, I'd expect to see something in your appraisal that says, here are your accountabilities, how are you getting on with delivering them? The third tool in the toolbox is Think Local. So this is part of our localism strategy. This is about how do we empower communities to get on and do things for themselves, to find local solutions to problems that are important to them. Our local councillors are going to be really important in doing this, and it's sometimes talked about the local council being the cabinet member in their area, pulling together partners, finding solutions and ways to make things work. And a county council that is able to devolve resources and decisions to local communities where they're able to deal with it better than we can, because what's needed is a different solution in every area. We've got lots of information available on this in SID, and we've got the results of the consultation going to Cabinet in September. And part of what we're working up next is leadership within the community. We've got a project running with six pilots about how our local member can be more active in pulling together local people, local resources to find local solutions. And we're putting together an offer to the community from the County Council. And that will include things like, we will work with you on local solutions to grit bins. We'll work with you on extending the parish lengthening scheme, positive activities for young people, and libraries. And that's our starting point for the community offer. And we expect, as we grow the thinking on this, that we'll be able to add more things into that. Systems and access is the next tool. This is all getting a bit long in detail. I've got to rush through this last bit. Systems and access is about how do we make it easier for people to use our technology and make it work for them. Particularly things like our main operating system is SAP. At the moment, we only use a fraction of the SAP functionality. We don't get the best out of the system that we've paid for. So we've rolled it out recently. People Online is about extending the HR elements of SAP. There are others that we're going to be pushing as well. Increasingly, we will be looking to use standard IT systems and not bespoke ones. We're not going to be building, and well, probably not going to be building any more systems of our own, which we've got a bit of a history of doing. And if we buy one off the shelf, we're not going to be commissioning lots of extra bells and whistles that go with it, because all of those cause complications in terms of making it work in the long run and talking to other systems. We have over 300 software packages in use in the council. Some of them only used by a couple of people, as well as the big ones like SAP that are used by hundreds of people. And we're looking to reduce that to under 100, and that will make life a lot easier. Tri-Council, I've talked about. This is the work with Staffordshire and Shropshire. There are five areas on the list, but Worcestershire is only involved in these four. So economic growth and connectivity. So an early win we are hoping for is that on broadband, in terms of the national rollout, Shropshire is well ahead of us on the list. We are hoping that through the Tri-Council project, we will be able to join Shropshire where they are on the list, instead of staying where we are, which is considerably further back in terms of the date of implementation. Fostering and adoption in residential care, information and communications, and contract management are the other areas. Now, you will have seen some of you the headlines in the Worcester News that said, is this the end of local in local government? Well, the answer is no, it isn't. Services that are provided to people in Worcestershire will continue to be provided to people in Worcestershire if we go ahead with these schemes, and we're still at the exploratory stage. There's nothing given yet. If it doesn't work for Worcestershire, we're not going to be doing it, but we think it's worth exploring. If we were to go ahead with a single fostering and adoption scheme, for example, it doesn't mean that people from Worcestershire would have to travel to Staffordshire or Shropshire to get a service. It might be managed that way. We might, for example, share marketing and recruitment and approval of adopters or for very specialist parts of the service. Those are the sorts of things we're talking about. But the people who live locally will still get their services locally. It's not going to be exported somewhere else. So that's what we want to try and do. I think the question is, what will success look like and how will we know if we've achieved it? And I've just got a few slides to run through and then I'm finished. One of the things that we've done consistently all the way through the BOLD programme is go out and talk to residents, and it's really worked for us. We've had over 30,000 individual respondents responses to consultation about what's important to you, what are the things that most need to be protected, what are the things that the County Council doesn't need to be doing as much of, and consultation to specific, responses to specific consultation as well. And that's given us some very, very clear feedback, which has really helped the council take decisions that would otherwise be very, very difficult. And I don't think we should undervalue that. And one of the things we said as a council is that we will come up with ideas, we will go out and talk to people, but we're not foolish enough to think that we necessarily have the best ideas in the world. And part of the point of consultation is to go out and see if people have different ideas about how we can do stuff. We're happy to be a listening council, and we don't see it as an embarrassment if we suddenly, you know, if we change our conclusion at the end of a consultation period because we've had different feedback. So, for example, on bus subsidies, our proposal was that we simply close down 75 routes. The public came back and said, no, that's not what we want. We understand why you need to make the savings, but actually we'd rather you shaved a bit off a lot of routes and kept more of them. And so that's what we did, and I think that was the right thing to do, and as a consequence, the vast majority of local people were happier with the outcome. When we allocated the positive activities for young people budgets out to the district areas, we went out and said, here are the criteria for how the money should be allocated across the six parts of Worcestershire. And young people came back and said, actually, we don't think you've got that quite right. You've done a lot of it by head of population, and we don't think you've paid enough attention to levels of need and deprivation. And so we changed the allocation structure because that was the feedback we got, and I think we got a better result as a consequence. We consulted on the kinship strategy for the way children in care are looked after by members of their extended family, and what came back was your proposed solution isn't the best one. Actually, if you went for this other slightly different solution, it's going to cost you a little bit more, but you'll get a much better result as a consequence. And that's what Council agreed to do, and I think we have got a better result as a consequence. Library consultations, we came up with what we thought was a cracking idea for Pershore Library. Let's put it in the District Council offices. It's only up the road. We can save shed loads of money and it'll still be a good service. Pershore Town Council, Pershore local people said, well, that's a right stupid idea, isn't it? It's going to kill our town centre off. And actually, what we'd be much better doing is listen to us, and they came up with a proposal where the Town Council bought the library building. We'll continue to provide the books and some staffing. They're going to move the tourist information office and some other voluntary activities into the library. They'll recruit volunteers. It's saving us the money we need to save. The library will be open to the public for book borrowing for longer hours, much better solution. So lots and lots of examples like that where we are keen to be a listening council, and changing our mind in response to what people tell us is not a sign of weakness, it is a sign of strength. I think it's a sign of a good council, and I'm very proud of it. We've got the balanced scorecard coming through. I'm not going to talk a lot about this because it's quite detailed, but it's taken us some time to work out if these are the things we said in our corporate plan are really important to us, how are we going to know whether it's working when we try and do something about it? We've come up with a balanced scorecard approach which operates at corporate level across the council, at directorate level for each directorate, and then at service and team level below that. So there's a thread that runs all the way through. We've spent about 6 to 8 months getting the information, making sure it's right and that it's timely. Still haven't cracked absolutely every problem there, but we're nearly there with it. And from quarter two next year, we will be making, the information is already available on SID, but from quarter two's figures, we will be, which will be published in December, they will be going on live on the public website even before this information gets to Cabinet. And this is part of the Council's commitment to be open and transparent with the public. If they want to come and see how we're doing, they can have a look at that information. I think that's quite a brave decision on our part. I think it's the right decision to do. And it will keep us on our toes. We said these things are important. If we're doing well, I want us to get the credit. If we're not doing well, then we need to be able to justify why not. So, terms and conditions, I think this is coming up to the last couple of slides. Lots of changes as a result of the consultation with staff that took place last year. The changes that have already come in, the disturbance allowance, sick pay and meals and car allowances and the 3 unpaid days leave. We've still got to come changes to protected annual leave from people who had more before before the Hereford and Worcester split. Sickness absence. This was a subject of huge discussion with staff at the roadshows about how this is going to work. And the figures are really interesting. If you have a look at it, overall sickness absence is down by 15%. Short-term absence is down by 43%. That is absolutely amazing. Now, these are fairly, we're just kind of getting the first quarter's figures into the second quarter now, so this is still early days. Whether it'll stay like that or not, I don't know. And without doubt, some of that will be the kinds of things that staff were raising the alarm bells about, people coming into work when they were really too ill to be here. But I can't believe for a minute that a 43% reduction was all entirely due to people coming in to work who shouldn't be here. And I actually think the original proposals that came through the staff suggestion box that said, why don't we change this because there's a few people having a day off when actually maybe they didn't really need it. I think this looks to me like that bears that out. I'd be interested in your views about this. I don't know, maybe that's just my view. I'd be interested to hear what anybody else has to say. And 170 employees bought additional leave. That saved us £160,000. We've lots of frequently asked questions about commissioning. I think I've probably covered those in the programme, but if there are others that you want to ask, I'm happy to take those at the end. And then I just wanted to finish off with the pledge that we made to you. We tried putting this on the screensaver, or some of it on the screensaver, and we had 500 staff saying, how can you do this to us? This is terrible. Yeah. So that was interesting. We did. And we started off bold 2 or 3 years ago saying, there is a big change coming up and we need to be ready for it. We don't want to be doing a slash and burn at the last minute. Since then, the period has extended, the amount we have to save has extended, and our ambitions about how we're going to deal with it have extended as well. But actually, the starting point is the same. Change isn't easy. In fact, it's very difficult. It makes people very anxious. But we can't avoid this change. We can't make it go away, and therefore our job is to manage it as responsibly as we can. So we understand the uncertainty, and our commitment to you continues to be that we will run an open and inclusive process with good two-way communications. We think we've made a reasonably good start on that, but we don't get it right every time, and it's important that you keep telling us if we don't get it right or if you've got ideas about how we could do it better. We will listen to your ideas and your concerns, and I've given lots of examples today, both where the ideas have come from staff, but also where the concerns that have come from staff have changed the final outcome of the proposal. And our commitment continues to be to minimise compulsory redundancies, and we're doing quite well on that, and we will continue with the rigorous vacancy management that we're doing that helps us achieve that. Our values continue to be really important to us, focusing on the needs of our customers, finding a can-do culture, finding solutions to problems, and giving you freedom within boundaries. Now, I think we can do better on this last one in the next couple of years. So, We're going Corporate Strategy Week in September, another round of consultation with residents and businesses and staff in the autumn, and linking the medium-term financial plan, the BOLD programme and the corporate plan together as we move forward into next year. Lots of information, you can pick these up on the on SID, and if there are any individual detailed questions, you can email me at Talk to Trish, you can talk to your line manager, you can talk to HR if it's a HR type issue. Please don't sit and stew on anything on your own. Go and ask a question. Right, we're going to have to cut this down drastically. That was ridiculously long. So my apologies. We'll take any questions or comments now. And we have a microphone as well.
Gentlemen at the back.
Oh, excellent.
Hello. I asked this question as an employee of Worcestershire County Council and not as a city councillor. In relation to Friday's decision to grant permission for the incinerator, which is a PFI project which we'll be paying for, what do you think will be the impact on other budgets, given that we'll be locked into paying for this over 25 to 30 years? Where do you see the money coming from to pay for the incinerator? That's basically the question. Thank you.
Quite an interesting question, because there's been a lot of rather bizarre speculation from Wales, and I don't quite get where they've got this figure of £1 billion the incinerator is going to cost us. Because the money will either come from the council can borrow it itself, or it will come from the private sector. Our contractors will provide the money. We will repay that over a 25-year period through a tonnage gate fee. Now, this is, of course, the subject of considerable negotiation. But one thing I am quite sure about, and that is that landfill taxes will continue to escalate, because by 2025 we are meant to have stopped all landfill in this country, and indeed across the EU. So the argument really is, in my view, what if you don't go down a waste-to-energy plant? What are the alternatives? Now, we've spent 8 years, in effect, looking at the alternatives, and we think this is the most risk-free and reliable alternative there is, and most councils are moving in this direction. The only council that didn't move in this direction was Wakefield, who built an autoclave plant, but you still have to, as the inspector said in his report, incinerate the results, the residue that comes out of it. And I'd also point out that Wakefield's plant blew up and killed two of their employees and seriously injured three of the others. So it doesn't strike me as being a particularly good waste disposal method. But an old treasurer here used to say to me, you can do anything you like with the county council budget, but you always have to dispose of the waste.
Hello, my name is Tim Wright. New employees here are contracted to a 35-hour week. And when you may change your job or get promotion or similar, if you're on 37 hours, it goes to 35. Is there any vision or intention for every employee here within, say, a next 5-year duration to go from a 37 to a 35-hour week?
Right. No, we're not looking for doing this in a fixed time scale. but the expectation is over time that's what will happen. In fact, you're not quite right in what you said about if you move to a new job or you get promotion. If you are moving to a different job and you would be financially disadvantaged by going to 35 hours, then we won't do that. If you're going for promotion and your pay would still kind of stay at the same level or go up, then you would be expected to take the 35-hour week arrangement. Can I just check, Stuart, is that right? Sorry?
If you went to a new job and it stumped you and you wanted this by that, your pay would be increased to a higher scale, so you weren't detrimental.
Yes, so we don't expect staff to do this up to their detriment. Okay. But we were very clear that at the moment we haven't set any timescales. Now, there may come a tipping point, I don't know when it might be, that actually we've got such a high proportion of staff on this that we'd want to shift the rest, but we're not anywhere near thinking about that at the moment.
Yeah. Can you tell us anything about the structure of the JCU when so many teams will be moved into it?
About the?
JCU.
JCU. Probably not a lot. Can we turn the lights up a bit, please?
No.
Can I say something about the structure of the JCU? No, I can't. I'm not close enough to know that level of detail. Is there anybody from the JCU here? Are you in a position to answer that? Do you want to? Where's the microphone?
You got it. No.
The Joint Commission Uni, both from an adults and a children's point of view, came together on the 1st of July. And then on the 1st of October, the plan is that supporting people, the drug and alcohol action team, brokerage and contracts also come into the Joint Commissioning Units. And then we're planning that as of the 1st of April next year, our public health commissioning component of public health will come into the Joint Commissioning Unit. So it's very much a phased plan. And then we're looking for a new structure as of the 1st of April, once we've got everybody within the Joint Commissioning Unit. So those are the plans at the moment.
So people won't be able to hear you. You'll need to... Sorry.
On the first email we had about transferring to the JCU, it said elements of supporting people will be moved. And I just wanted to know if it was the budget, staff, part of the staff. Is the commissioning unit just commissioners, no finance function or admin?
I think we probably, that's getting very detailed, more detail we can do here. Can you two have a conversation about this afterwards and we'll try and get you the information that we've got? Is that okay?
Yeah. I've got another question, if that's all right.
Oh, yes, go on.
There's a new consultation going out shortly about charging older people for call alarms. How will that promote independence?
Charging older people for?
Call alarms. The consultation is for older people saying, are you prepared to pay between £1 and £4 a week for your call alarm? Supporting people provides 8,000 call alarms in Worcestershire.
Right.
And they all get them free because they're on housing benefit.
Okay. I'm not familiar with the details of that consultation. I'm sorry, it's a very specific service bit that I don't know the answer to, but again, I can go and find out. But if I can set this in a slightly wider context, one of the things that we've thought about as a county council is, and older people service is a very good example of this, do we provide services to every older person for free? In other words, are they subsidised by the county council regardless of that older person's financial position? And we undertook a major review of this in relation to other charges for daycare, daycare, home care, respite care last year. And the outcome of that was that we said, no, actually, we didn't think it was very sensible or very fair to just say, if you happen to be over 65, regardless of what your financial circumstances are, we're not going to ask you to pay anything for a service. We didn't think that was fair, because what it meant was that the County Council taxpayers were subsidising some people who had quite reasonable levels of income. And so for all of those other services, we actually introduced, it came into being, I think, in April this year, we introduced differential charges for services. So for older people, two things happen. One is you have an assessment of needs, what sort of services do you need? And the second is that you have a financial assessment, and if you're assessed as having sufficient income to pay a charge, then you have to pay a charge if you want to use the service. Of course, lots of older people don't have extra income, and if you're on, you know, basic income support and old age pension, then you're assessed as not having enough income to pay a charge. But if you've got an occupational pension, for example, then you may well be assessed to have a charge. Now, it's the same principle, as far as I can see from what you said, about do we charge for alarms at home. I think that's a perfectly reasonable question to go out and ask in consultation.
But you did say the 8,000 more on housing benefits. Well, I find it's somewhat strange.
I think you're going to, if you sent me a couple more details, I'm not familiar with the consultation you're talking about, but if you sent me a couple more details, I'll find out and get back to you. And you can do that on Talk to Tricia, just direct on email. Okay. Any more? Anybody else?
You mentioned putting the balance scorecard out to the public.
Yes.
It may just be me, but I find it almost unintelligible. What do you think the public are going to make of it?
Very helpful bit of feedback. We haven't got an example on here, have I?
Not easily. No.
It would all work there. Sorry, don't worry. We're trying, and we haven't quite got there yet, to make both the objective that we're trying to achieve, together with the measurement by which we're going to know whether we're achieving it, simple. Sometimes that's very difficult because there are actually, okay, so here's an example. Actually, some things are really quite difficult to measure. There may not be a direct measurement of them. So this has got, so this is the high level one, corporate balance scorecard. Beneath this sits a directorate scorecard. Beneath that, service, and beneath that, a team scorecard. Some of these are very straightforward in the sense that, improve the availability of high-speed broadband. Well, that's relatively straightforward. There's a straight percentage. We'll have 90% coverage by, that's relatively easy to understand. And then the comment on the right should help explain either why we're doing well or if we're not doing well, what are we doing about it? They're not all as easy to measure as that. The open for business ones tend to be relatively straightforward, but by the time you get to, let's have a look, try and pick another example out.
There was one I spotted this morning.
Which one?
It was number of children KSI in RTA.
Oh, God.
Yeah, children's right. Services okay. Engine and road traffic accidents,
right.
Too.
You've got to understand that most of these are written by anoraks who love their area of work. Don't always talk in a language that everybody else can understand. So part of the reason for, first, we started off by discussing this in service areas on directorates and at home. Going back through the information each quarter, was it understandable? Have we got the right indicator? Some of the indicators are ones that we've inherited nationally that are good to use because it allows us to compare ourselves with others. But how do we write that in a way that makes sense to a layperson, never mind one of our own staff? So I hear what you said. It's a bit of a challenge. The other challenge is, in the comments column, trying to write this in a way that makes sense to a layperson. Some of the officer comments on the right-hand column are almost as impenetrable as the example you gave. We've made some progress in that, but to be honest, there is something, in my experience, as soon as you put this stuff on the table in the public domain and all of a sudden you get lots of questions about it, there is nothing guaranteed to make the person leading on it take it more seriously, more quickly. Yeah. So, you know, I'm quite happy to put it out there, and I know we won't have it perfect by then, but actually the feedback we get from the public will help us get it better.
I mean, just to say, I mean, the balanced scorecard is, you know, come from, you know, the private sector in the 90s, where it was an approach to try and deal with the short-termism of financial reporting. So some of these targets will be, you know, deliberately so, long-term. And of course, the other thing that I'm very keen on is, you know, it isn't just really a scorecard for Worcestershire County Council, a service report. It is a Worcestershire scorecard, but we are running it. So, you know, things like the economy, well, the County Council can have some impact on that, but frankly, it's pretty limited. But I think we need somewhere to report it, and the same with road traffic accident statistics.
Not the principle
of the that's all right then. It's so, just as normal, the way that we've managed to do it.
I can't actually find the one you're talking about on the corporate scorecard. When I say
it's here below.
Because we've got scorecards exist at different levels, the two levels that will be made available on the public website are the corporate one and the directorate one. Realistically, the more you go down into service on team level, the more very, very detailed and the targets are, and it will include things like you've just described. Those aren't going to be available to the public, at least not yet. The important thing is that the people who use them understand those. But we do need to get the public facing ones right. Anybody want to comment about anything else? I mean, you know, last roadshow we had loads of stuff about the changes in terms and conditions. I'd be interested if you've got any feedback about how that's gone. If anybody's got any comments.
There were a couple of comments about the sick leave issues. One is, I've just come back from sick leave, so I've experienced it. It does seem very time-consuming for admin staff to actually deal with the whole process. There's been a lot of emails to and from HR and admin time. Has that been sort of metered into the costings? Because it's costing an awful lot of time, staff time, to actually deal with it.
We have a HR person here who will be able to answer that question.
And the second part of it is, why in the deductions of salary does it come off at weekends as well when you don't work weekends?
Right. I get so more questions about this. I'll talk to Trish and anybody else. And the answer is always the same. Stuart.
I can't see the second one.
Just, can you have to stand up?
Sorry. The first question, in terms of cost of admin time, then, that's the process you're making in terms of reporting that you've been off sick.
Going between HR. Do I need that or not?
No.
To answer your question, I don't think we looked at specific process yet, but I'm more than happy to talk to you about your own experience, if you like, and see whether we can improve the process, any particular bottlenecks that you experienced. So I'll talk to you separately afterwards, if that's okay. I can't remember the exact equation in terms of the weekend working, but again, I can come back on that. I think it's really on frequently asked questions, isn't it?
Can you put us back on the main thing? The answer is to do with the fact that we're grappling with two different systems relating to sick pay that have two different statutory systems that have two different statutory requirements, one of which relates to a seven-day week and the other of which relates to the week that you work. Okay, and it's trying to mesh those two together that leaves us in this rather odd position where if you go off on Friday on sick and you don't declare yourself well on Saturday and Sunday, even though you wouldn't have worked on those days, then you end up losing 3 days sick pay. So it does seem an odd thing to ask staff to do, but it's in order to try and bring two statutory systems together. And if you're unclear, there's a whole kind of section on this on SID. Okay. Right. Okay. Anybody else on any of the changes? Has it made much difference? I know there was an awful lot of anxiety about it 6 months ago when we were doing the road shows. Have you noticed it making much difference? Or does it sit by largely unnoticed?
What, sick pay?
Sick pay.
Well, I certainly noticed that there's the vast majority of the people I've worked with, you know, wouldn't dream of having a day's sick. They've been quite poorly, but they've still come into work purely from the point of view that they will be losing the pay, you know, and
you know, it's something I haven't really sort of come across too much in the past in my sort of experience of working. But, you know, I would say that the vast majority of the people who actually work in my area would definitely come in. It's been discussed, of course. No, I can't afford to have a day off sick. I will sort of come in no matter what. So right. That's the only comment I can really make. And those are my observations.
But helpful to have that. Thank you. Can I check? One of the things, as a result of staff feedback, was that we set up an arrangement where you could have, is it up to five? Stuart, is it up to 5 days? You could draw up to 5 days from your annual leave. So this was the way we thought, okay, well, actually, this might help if somebody feels too ill to come in, doesn't want to take a day off because they can't afford to lose the pay, they can, by agreement, use one of their annual days' pay. And bear in mind that you all got 3 unpaid days' leave. Everybody had 3 to start with. Has anybody done that, and how did it work? I'll come back to you in a second. I haven't forgotten you.
Thank you. Towards the end of the last financial year, I was unfortunate to have a stomach upset, so I did take 2 days off work. I found that my dilemma, having found that I wasn't able to attend work, was actually deciding whether I took leave or was in a position to take leave or whether I lost the pay. That did cause anxiety at the time. Now, that you could say was short-lived, but I think for people who are unfortunately ill, they shouldn't have to be worrying about whether to lose pay or take days leave. Fortunately for me, it was at the end of the year I had days in hand, so I took leave.
Okay.
But I do feel that in certain circumstances it is an issue where you're not well and you've got the additional worry of deciding how you deal with that.
I understand that. On the other hand, I don't feel in a position where I want to take that choice away from people, although I can accept that, you know, in making that choice there's a bit of worry attached to it. But I'd rather you had the choice than me saying I'm not going to let you have that choice. Let me come back to this lady in the middle who's had her hand up several times.
Just following on from that chap's point over there about people come in, the fact it depends how you measure the success of that criteria. If it's just that people are in the office, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's a success. It's success from the point of view that there's people in the office, but it doesn't actually address the staff welfare issue of people are in when perhaps they should be off.
We are very clear that if people are too ill to be in work, their manager has a responsibility to send them home. We're clear about that as an employer. That's our responsibility. So I would not find it acceptable that somebody struggling to work so ill that either they were putting their colleagues at risk or they were, you know, jeopardising their own health. Early days yet. We'll see where we go with this. But I have to tell you, 43% was a much bigger reduction than I had expected.
It's just interesting on the 43% is how it was made up. I mean, had it been you targeted the managers of the groups that were causing concerns before, what the difference would have, you know, shown?
Well, we've been running for some years now. We're running a fairly tight ship about targeting individuals where there were patterns of sickness, you know, the kind of stuff that staff were feeding through the suggestion box to us and, about, you know, people who have regular Fridays off or, you know, whatever. And, you know, again, there's a combination of, you know, wanting to make sure that people are pulling their weight and not expecting colleagues to pick up the slack, but also that if we have somebody who's got a persistent health problem, we have a responsibility as an employer to find out how can we support them in dealing with that. So we had a fairly robust and well-developed and well-used system for following through with staff when they come back off sick, having a conversation with your manager that says, are you okay? You know, this has happened before. Is there a persistent issue, that health issue that I need to be aware of? You know, is there anything that we can do in the job to make the job kind of work better for you, etc.? And sometimes, if it's not actually ill health, but it's another problem, like I've got childcare difficulties, is there another way that we can deal with that without you having to take time off sick to do it? You know, and I see all of that as being part of a good employer. So I don't think there was an awful, you can always improve on this stuff, of course you can, but I don't, it's not that we weren't doing anything, and if we kind of focused on that we would have made huge improvements, because I don't think there were huge improvements to make. Did you want to say? You looked very purposeful there.
No.
Okay.
So I'm going to sound really negative again. This thing about productivity, about whether you're actually productive when you're in, yes, you're not very well, I do have concerns about that. I mean, I had, very soon after the scheme started, I had a migraine, which I get once, twice a year, maybe, maximum. I didn't, normally I would take medication, sleep it off, take one day off and be back in next day, fighting fit. Because of the new scheme, I didn't take time off, I didn't take my medication, I came in very bleary-eyed, probably shouldn't have been here. And I'll be perfectly honest, I was unproductive all week until I got to the weekend and I could sleep it off. I don't feel I really got over that migraine.
Okay.
Now, I don't feel, if I'd had one day off in the old system, I feel I would have had a productive week the other 3 days of the week.
Right.
Because I struggled in, I feel it was 4 days wasted.
Okay.
So I was here, and your stats show I was here, but yeah, I don't think I was doing my job properly.
Okay. Well, that'll be an interesting thing to try and follow through about whether the reducing absence figure, whether we can show whether it relates to improved productivity or not. It's probably a bit too early to say yet, to be honest, but we'll see. Okay. You can ask about any of the stuff that came up today, any other issues. Are there any other areas of concern about the kinds of things Adrian and I were talking about? No? Anything else anybody wants to raise? Do you feel... in terms of the kinds of things we were talking about today, I'm sorry, because you're the guinea pigs, we'll change some of the slides. It was a bit too long and a bit too detailed, I think, for what was needed today. But was there much in there that is a surprise to you? Because my ambition is that actually I'm telling you stuff that you already know, that there's not an awful lot of surprises in here because our communication is good and you're picking it up from other sources as well. You feel comfortable? It's what you're expecting.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's helpful.
I think the bold bite size meetings that you put in for managers, yeah, those are extremely useful as well.
Is that good?
On a regular basis, you,
okay,
get a bite size of what the headlines,
yeah, right,
are. So it makes it more digestible.
Right. So that was, for those at the back who might not have heard that, we started after each bold program board. So the program board meets once a month. After each one, a senior manager and a senior politician will come and meet whichever managers want to come and kind of get an update on what happened at the programme board that month, and it's an opportunity to ask questions and answers. So we're trying different things as a way of helping people keep up with, you know, current changes and what's happening, and have a chance to check out whether they've got, you know, got the information right, or if they're having concerns expressed by staff, they can fairly quickly and informally explore those. Okay, unless there's anyone else, I think we'll say thank you very much. I hope you felt it was a good use of your time. And can I please hold you to the bit about talking to colleagues about some of the messages and directing them to where they can find the slides on SID. Okay, thank you very much indeed.